Listening Library presents The Natural Genius of Ants by Betty Culley. Read for you by Alejandro Ruiz. Chapter 1. The Mistake. Dad said being in Kettle Hole was like going back in time, but I didn't know what he meant until we got here. The trees are tall and straight, and farm fields stretch out to the sky. There are gigantic bullfrogs with eyes as big as nickels, and trucks filled with logs rumble down the dirt roads, blowing up dust. Instead of streetlights shining outside our windows, we're in a place so dark, at night you feel invisible. A place where you hear coyotes howl and yip. Dad says they live deep in the woods, even though it sounds like they're very close. We came here because of my father's mistake. He can't forgive himself for what he did. It doesn't matter that he's a doctor, and doctors make mistakes like everybody else. After the baby died, Mom tried to explain why Dad was so sad. She said people are human, and she'd gotten things wrong at work, too. "Did any parasites die?" I asked. She's studying a parasite that makes people lose their vision. It's so small, you can only see it through a special microscope. My little brother Roger's eyes got very big. Since Dad's mistake, my mouth has been on autopilot. Harford! Mom said my name once, like a warning, and quickly looked around to see if Dad had heard me. Luckily, he hadn't. For 5 months after his mistake, Dad didn't work. He didn't leave our apartment on the fifth floor except to get a haircut. He cried when no one was looking, and even when everyone was looking. Then he got the idea for us to go to Kettle Hole for the summer, the place where he grew up. His childhood friend Vernon Knowles was renting out his house 6 states away from our apartment and the hospital where Dad used to work. "You know I can't leave my research right now," Mom said when Dad told us about his plan. "I know you can't leave the parasites. They need you so much. They depend on you. They can't live without you," I said. Mom and I collect parasite jokes. Later, I overheard Mom and Dad talking in their bedroom. She asked him why he wanted to go to Kettle Hole. In his thought-out, list-making way, he gave her 3 reasons.
"People know me as the Corson boy there, not Dr. Corson. Kettle Hole is always in my heart, even though I haven't been back since my grandfather's funeral. And Robert Frost was right, that home is the place where, when you have to go there, they have to take you in."
Mom had 1 answer to his 3 reasons. "If that's what you need to do, Marshall." Dad answered back,
"Vern thought Erlene would make it, but she's been gone 6 months, and he's in a spot trying to pay off her medical bills and raise his daughter. He was going to lose the house, and we need a place to stay. Give me this time with the boys, Dee. Maybe I can do something right and make it a summer they will always remember."
It was quiet then, and I peeked into their room. Mom had her arms around Dad, her cheek pressed against his. He just stood there with his arms hanging down, like he didn't have enough energy to hug her back. Mom answered,
"You were born to be a doctor, Marshall. Please, use this summer to figure out a way to forgive yourself."
To get to Kettle Hole, we drove east for more than a day and then headed north. The highway in Maine was only 2 lanes, and the farther north we went, the less cars there were on the road. I've never been to the town where my father grew up. Mom grew up in the city where we live, but Mom's mother, my abuela, is from the Dominican Republic. I've never been there either. Part of the year, she lives right near us, and part of the year, she goes back to the DR to see family.
"The fields and the woods are just how I remember,"
Dad said when we got off the highway.
"It's like going back in time."
"Then you better speed up," I blurted out. Dad drove exactly 5 miles under the speed limit, both hands on the wheel.
"Why would I want to do that?"
he asked without turning his head away from the road. "So we get there before you're too young to drive. And I'm only 10, so if you go too slow, I'll disappear." I saw a little smile on Dad's face in the rearview mirror, but he didn't drive any faster. Being on a long car trip makes you think about things. Roger, I know, thought about one thing. The food in the cooler on the back seat between us. He'd watched Dad fill it, and he had a contest with himself to eat some of everything packed in there. Grapes, cheese slices, juice boxes, macaroni and cheese, oatmeal raisin cookies. Mom wouldn't have let Roger eat so much, but Dad was busy driving. And when Roger had food in his mouth, he wasn't asking the same thing over and over. What do you think Mommy is doing right now? Or saying, if Mommy was here, she'd sing the car song. I have no idea what the car song is, but Roger sang the only lines he remembered until they were stamped in my brain. Car, car, car. Far, far, far. While Roger ate, I looked out my window and thought about the things people say about mistakes, all of which are wrong. Mistakes happen. Don't be afraid to make mistakes. It's only a mistake. You learn from your mistakes. Don't worry. It was an honest mistake. None of those things are true, I thought, because if they were, Dad would still be taking care of the smallest and sickest babies in the hospital instead of planning our summer to remember. Roger wouldn't be one state away from a bellyache after eating his 100th snack. All I could do, as we got closer and closer to Kettle Hole, was hope that going back to the place where Dad grew up wouldn't turn out to be another mistake. Chapter 2. One word or two? When we finally pull up in front of Mr. Knowles' house in Kettle Hole, it's dark all around us, with only one light shining on a porch the whole length of the house. Dad shuts off the motor and opens the car door. Roger snores in his sleep.
Listen,
Dad says.
Barred owls.
There's an eerie hooting noise, and then cries like monkeys screaming. Dad stands there looking into the woods where the sounds are coming from. Do you have the key to the house? I ask.
It should be open,
he says. That's how I end up being the first one in, carrying my backpack over my shoulder. I feel for a switch on the wall, and the room lights up. The floor is wood, and the house smells like the cabin I stayed in at summer camp last year. It's colder inside the house than outside. The living room has a couch and chair at one end, and a desk and floor lamp in a corner. There's a kitchen with a square table and four chairs. The windows are low and tall, and none of them have curtains. Up a set of stairs are three bedrooms and a bathroom. One bedroom has a big bed like Mom and Dad's. I drop my backpack on the bed in the smaller of the other two. This way, there's no tears from Roger for getting the worst room. Plus, the smallest room has a window that looks out onto a roof and a long closet under a sloping wall. That night, I fall asleep on the bed in the room without even taking my sneakers off. The morning after we arrive, I'm the last one awake. Dad is in the kitchen and I smell his coffee brewing. Roger is at the kitchen table. What are Roger and I going to do here? I ask Dad.
Any number of things,
he says.
See what catches your eye, where your interests take you.
Dad's face is pale from spending the past 5 months inside. His eyelash is almost see-through, and his hair is the same light brown as Roger's, but thinner on top. What about you? What are you going to do? I ask him.
I'm going to work on being a better parent,
he says. Better how? Who are you competing against? The words are out before I have a chance to think. Dad answers in a serious voice.
Better in all ways, Harvard. More involved, more focused, more adaptable.
You're hired. When can you start? Dad ignores or doesn't notice that I'm being mouthy. He drops toast on plates, puts out jelly, shakes the orange juice container, and spins silverware across the table so it lands exactly in front of where we're each sitting. Then he sits down and clasps his hands on the table in front of himself. He's wearing a white short-sleeved button-down shirt, and in the front pocket, there's a pen and a mini notepad.
I didn't bring the computer because there's no internet connection in the house. It's also hard for me to get reception on my cell phone unless I'm outside. But anytime you want to call Mom, you can use the house phone there on the desk.
Is that what you meant by going back in time? I ask.
Internet access and TV.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.